Proverbs chapter 6, verses 16 to 19, gives to us seven things that God hates. You would notice in the Bible that there are a number of reference lists concerning what is sin. And God wants us to know that which He hates. These sins that He has listed here, are not an exhaustive list of sins, but here the Lord wants to impress upon our hearts how sin causes a separation between man and God. It was sin that causes Adam and Eve to first have to be banished from the Garden of Eden. We may say that they were tempted. Adam and Eve were tempted by the serpent, who subtly came to them to entice them, to lure them, to seduce them, and finally to ensnare them when they would take the bait and sin. The only point of contest that God has for them, that they must not eat of the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Why is it that men will not or has not and choose not the good things? Why is it that men would rather go for those things that would harm them? Those things that God hates are those things that would harm us. Why is it that we would not choose the way of blessing, the way of our for our protection? Rather, we would choose the way of cursing, the way of punishment, the way of chastisement, the way of judgment. How is it that there is that tendency within us that would cause us to so easily yield to temptation? As we examine life and the life of God's people, we realize how weak we are. How is it that when we are tempted, we would choose to yield? And God is gracious. He gives to us the free will after He has freed us from the bondage of sin to choose not to go back to the vomit, not to partake of those things that would harm us. And yet, we see another member within us that is so active, energizing us to destruction. How frightening it is. And for the Christian, when God has given to us salvation in Jesus Christ, He also puts in us by His Holy Spirit a fear to displease God, a fear to sin against Him, a fear of judgment that will come as a result of sin. And the more we would spend time with God in prayer, in the study of God's Word, the more He would give us a heightened sensitivity to what is sin and the consequence of it. And it is so, we are so blessed that God gives to us this book of Proverbs that so succinctly put together those things that would help us in our spiritual life, and those things that would pull us apart from God. And our text gives to us these things that the Lord wants us to consider. Proverbs chapter 6 and verse 16 tells us, "These six things doth the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination unto him." He's listing, as it were, to us a wholesome and yet not exhaustive list of actions. And you will notice in our text that it has to do with the various parts of our body, the various organs that make up our movements. Here is said, the look, the eye, the tongue, the hands, the heart, the feet. You'd realize that every part of our body can be yielded to sin or can be yielded to righteousness. When we yield ourselves to sin, there comes the darkness, the consequence of sin. And as we think of the ultimate consequence, you would find, as we mentioned last week, that there is an ultimate judgment upon all mankind. And those who have their sins not forgiven, right, you find that sin, a person plagued with the disease of sin, cannot enter heaven. Heaven will not allow anyone plagued with the disease of sin to heaven to enter. And the sad thing is that there will be those who will not enter into heaven. And it is frightening to see men and women choosing to forsake, to reject the passage to heaven. And we all know the consequence, the other place, the place of judgment, the place of hellfire, where the fire burns without ceasing. How frightening it is. And yet, we somehow are not able to understand and see the truth of it and the frightening nature of it and the ultimate consequence of our actions. And if we have understood this, then you'll find that your life would be one of vigilance. We would take time, spend time to feed ourselves strong in the Word of God. "Thy word have I hid in my heart," the psalmist says, "that I might not sin against thee." And we walk in that blessed path of God's protection, doing his will. So blessed, so beautiful. And daily, this is not such a far-fetched reality. It is a life that every born-again believer can live. And as we go through this list of sins, the Lord wants us to see clearly see clearly what these are. A proud look. Pride is this first sin. It is the sin that first came upon God's created universe after God said that everything was very good. Lucifer, the most beautiful of God's angel, fell in heaven because he thought himself so perfect that God has made him, that he began to believe in his own heart that his perfection, his beauty came from himself. And it's easy for us, well, God energizing us with strength, to think that this strength comes of our own, a mental faculty that God has bestowed upon us. It's easy for us to think that this is ours, but we need to realize that there is a God who has placed this faculty, that strength that is within us. Even the breath comes from him. And we know that Lucifer, Satan, was not thinking that way. The Bible tells us how he fell. "For thou hast said in thy heart," the Lord said to Lucifer, "I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God, I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sights of the north, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds, I will be like the Most High." Pride, the first sin, the sin that so easily beset us. The Lord wants us to look carefully and be sure that we will not have this proud look. Jesus, when he came upon earth, the first thing he pronounced to his disciples is the blessing upon those who have a poverty of spirit. He says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." It is said that the gates of heaven is quite low. Those who stand tall cannot enter. Well, what we are saying here is this, that the Lord wants us to understand that who we are is not of ourselves. But if we have understood that what we are, who we are, the breath that we have is given to us by the Almighty God, then we would have a sense of understanding of our existence. That's the beginning of wisdom, when we understand that we are not of ourselves. And it's so easy for us to get out of ourselves, to let pride come into us. That was what happened to Lucifer. And God said to him, "Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit." God wants us to realize how we must be careful. It began with a proud look. That proud look caused Lucifer to be cast down to heaven. And then he came as the serpent in the Garden of Eden with a lying tongue, speaking to God's created being. You know, the angels that fell, there's no return for them. There is no way back after they have fallen. But for us, men who are made in the image of God, there is a way back. There is a way back for us. We can still find hope and help when we would come back to the Lord. And so when Satan came, serpent said to Adam and Eve, "You shall not surely die when you would partake of the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." It was a lie, an outright lie. And yet, Adam and Eve believed a lie. We said, how come they are so gullible? Did not God already say to them so clearly? Well, it applies to us too. We have the Word of God with us to instruct us, to show us the way of wisdom. And yet, how is it that we can be so easily tricked, so easily schemed upon, so easily led astray? Well, I believe we have not understood what is sin. We have not come to a point where we truly wrestle with sin and fear its consequences, so much so that we would wage a do or die warfare. Adam and Eve was in that relaxed state when they fell. And the Lord wants us to see and understand. And that lying tongue, how is it that we can pull a straight face and speak falsehood without blinking our eyes? Wow, that is frightening. And hence that shed innocent blood, willing to go the way of evil. The heart that imagined wicked imagination, devices wicked imaginations, and feet that be swift in running to mischief. How can we understand this? Turn with me to 1 Kings 21. There was a man by the name of Naboth who lived during the time of the divided kingdom in the northern kingdom of Israel, where King Ahab was the king at that time and Jezebel was his wife. 1 Kings 21 tells us. And the Lord wants us to see what is wickedness. And it came to pass after these things that Naboth the Jezreelite had a vineyard which was in Jezreel, hard by the palace of Ahab, king of Samaria. So Naboth owns a vineyard that is neighbor to the king's palace. And Ahab one day says to Naboth, "Give me thy vineyard that I may have it for a garden of herbs, because it is near unto my house, and I will give thee for it a better vineyard than it, or if it seems good to thee, I will give thee the worth of it in money." In other words, he tells Naboth, "Sell me your land. Give it to me. I want it to plant some vegetables in my garden, and I would enjoy a vegetable meal. That is so good." Naboth said to Ahab, "The Lord forbid it me that I should give the inheritance of my fathers unto thee." You see, the land that is allocated to all the families in the various tribes in Israel were for a posterity. God gave to them the freehold land, and they are to pass it on, use it for their subsistence, for the glory of God, as a witness to the nations of the world. And that land is not to be sold. And so Naboth, doing the right thing, said to Ahab, although Ahab was the king, I cannot sell, because this is the inheritance of my fathers. And Ahab came to his house heavy and displeased because of the word which Naboth had spoken to him. And he said, I will not give thee the inheritance of my fathers. And he laid it down, he laid down upon his bed and turned upon his face and would eat no bread. He was unhappy. He was unhappy because he didn't get what he won. Does it not sound quite common? Something that you like, you don't get it, and you are upset because you don't get it. This is what you desire in your heart. And what did he do? Well, our text tells us, and Ahab said, and his wife came to him and said, why is thy spirit so sad that thou eatest no bread? And he said unto her, because I speak unto Naboth the Jezreelite, and said unto him, give me thy vineyard for money, or else, if it please thee, I give thee another vineyard for it. So it's quite reasonable, right, it seemed. And he answered, I will not give thee the vineyard. And Jezebel, his wife, said unto him, dost thou now govern the kingdom of Israel? Arise and eat thy bread, and let thine heart be merry. I will give thee the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite. Ah, here you are going to see how the hands would be used to shed innocent blood, and the heart that devises wicked imagination, and the feet that is swift, running to mischief. Surely they are comfortable with what they already have. How is it that there is not that contented spirit within him? There is that covetous spirit that is within him to want more. Greed. Oftentimes, fell many a good man. And Jezebel said, his wife said to him, and so she wrote, after consulting with Ahab, that they would do something, letters in Ahab's name, and seal them with his seal, and send letters unto the elders and to the nobles that were in the city dwelling with Naboth. And she wrote in the letters, proclaim a fast, set Naboth on high among the people, and set two men, sons of Belial, great sinners, before him to bear witness against him, saying, thou didst blaspheme God and the king, and then carry him out and stone him that he may die. Wow, that was the scheme. Get two false witnesses, and they would tell their lies, and then let the sentence be meted out and let him be stoned. Wow. If you are the family member of Naboth and your father faces such unjust situation, you said, oh, this is injustice. This is injustice. But the man had the power. The man had the army. The man could do what he wanted. So frightening, isn't it? And here, what did she write? She says, proclaim a fast. So she makes it such a legitimate trial. Let there be a fast proclaimed, and then let him be questioned. And what was the charge against Naboth? Thou didst blaspheme God and the king, and then carry him out and stone him that he may die. And the men of the city, even the elders and the nobles who were the inhabitants of his city, did as Jezebel had sent unto them, as it was written in the letters which she had sent unto them. They proclaimed a fast and set Naboth on high among the people. And there came two men, children of Belial, set before him, and the men of Belial witnessed against him, even against Naboth in the presence of the people, saying, Naboth did blaspheme God and the king. Then they carried him forth out of the city and stoned him with stones that he died. Then verse 14 says, they sent to Jezebel, saying, Naboth is stoned and is dead. And it came to pass, when Jezebel heard that Naboth was stoned and was dead, that Jezebel said to Ahab, arise, take possession of the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite, which he refused to give thee for money. For Naboth is not alive, but dead. What a scheme! He's a dead man now. And then it came to pass, when Ahab heard that Naboth was dead, that Ahab arose and go down to the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite to take possession of it. So what happened to wife and children and all the rest of the dependents of Naboth, with the head of the family dead? You must imagine and see the kind of weeping, the kind of terrible plight that has befallen the family. And the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite. You see, there is a God in heaven who looks down upon the affairs of men. And it's interesting that the God of heaven, who makes the heaven and the earth, would be so concerned about the little things, as it were, that comes in the lives of his people. But this is the God who makes the universe, who makes man in his image. He is one who has that knowledge and concern for every one of his children. If you are facing some injustice in your life, well, the Lord knows. The Lord sees from heaven and knows. And so God commanded Elijah the Tishbite to come. Verse 18 says, arise, go down to meet Ahab, king of Israel, which is in Samaria. Behold, he is in the vineyard of Naboth, whither he is gone down to possess it. So while he was going down to possess it, God already sent his prophet, told his prophet that this thing is going on. He's, you know, he has taken blood, shed blood, and now he wants to take possession. And here it is, God is already acting. You see the scene that is going on? Man doing his mischief and God intervening on the other hand. We realize that we are not living alone in this world. If you are God's children, well, you know that you have a God in heaven who protects you, who knows all that you have suffered. And so here it says, and the word of the Lord came to Elijah, that he would go down, and thou shalt speak unto him, saying, thus saith the Lord, hast thou killed and also taken possession. And thou shalt speak unto him, saying, Thus saith the Lord, in the place where dogs lick the blood of Naboth, shall dogs lick thy blood, even thine. So here it says that there is a judgment coming upon Ahab. And Elijah the prophet was sent by God to pronounce that judgment. How frightening, isn't it? Someone would scheme to shed someone else's blood. We realize that the blood of the shed that was shed, the person of the crieth out. And Ahab said to Elijah, Hast thou found me, O my enemy? And he answered, I have found thee, because thou hast sold thyself to work evil in the sight of the Lord. So God gives to us very clearly what is good and what is evil. And God, by his laws, teaches us. And God wants us to understand what is good and what is evil. And he bids us to love that which is good, as he gives to us in his commandments those things that he teaches us. Love the worship of God. Love the name of God. Love the day of God. Love the morality of men. Love the property of men. Love the prosperity of men, right? The property of your neighbor, the prosperity of your neighbor, morality of your neighbor, the life of your neighbor. And God's law gives to us how we are to live. Love these things. And when we love these things, well, God would add to us blessings upon blessings. But if we would spurn these things that God teaches us, then it is a fearful awaiting of judgment to come. And so here was Elijah confronting Ahab. Thus saith the Lord, in the place where dogs lick the blood of Naboth, shall dogs lick thy blood, even thine. And Ahab said to Elijah, Hast thou found me, O my enemy? And his son said, I have found thee, because thou hast sold thyself to work evil in the sight of the Lord. Behold, I will bring evil upon thee, and will take away thy posterity, and cut off from Ahab him that pisses against the wall, and him that shutteth up and left in Israel. Wow, God is going to clean house and will make thine house like the house of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, and like the house of Baasha, the son of Ahijah, for the provocation wherewith thou hast provoked me to anger and made Israel to sin. God is going to give that judgment. And Jezebel also spoke. And of Jezebel, the Lord also gave the judgment. The dogs shall eat Jezebel by the war of Jezebel. Him that dieth of Ahab in the city, the dogs shall eat. And him that dieth in the field shall the fowls of the air eat. But there was none like unto Ahab, which did sell himself to work wickedness in the sight of the Lord, whom Jezebel his wife stirred up. And he did abominably, following idols according to all things, as did the Amorites, whom the Lord cast out before the children of Israel. And so you see here that when our hearts are not whole toward God, when there are some idols that is holding on to our heart, that our hearts are chasing after, that's the beginning of trouble in a person's life. When our heart is not whole toward God, right? And there is something that we have loved and placed above God, that's the beginning of trouble in a person's life. And here you see in Ahab's life. And it came to pass, when Ahab heard these words, that he rent his clothes and put sackcloth upon his flesh and fasted and lay in sackcloth and went softly. So the fear of God came into his heart. The fear of God suddenly came into his heart. The judgment that is to come, how frightening it is. Well, it came upon Ahab at that time. And the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite. Seest thou how Ahab humbleth himself before me? Because he humbleth himself before me, I will not bring evil in his days, but in his son's days will I bring the evil upon his house. And so we see here the story of Ahab and the story of Jezebel. How frightening it is, right, to fall under the judgment of God. How he did begin, right, with that little desire in his heart. I want that. I want that. And this is what I want. Ah, that lead to all the trouble. Is there something that you want? Something that the Lord says, no, you should not have. Well, Ahab wanted something. And that desire in his heart caused him to begin to imagine how he would be able to get it. How frightening is this? And did he finally get what he wanted? Yes, he did. But he will pay a great price. The Lord wants us to understand here the motions of sin, right, how it is described here, right, the various actions of a man, how he comes, he thinks, and then he acts. Right, from that imagination, from the look to the heart, to the hands, to the feet. And finally, we saw the destruction. And so the Lord tells us, these six things that the Lord hates, seven are an abomination to him. Well, the Lord is saying to us that there are these sins, this list of sins, right, that God wants us to know, that would that is terrible in the sight of God, and God wants us to repent. If we are in any of this, and here the last one, he speaks of sowing discord among brethren. Is it such a bad sin? You see families break up. You see churches break up. When there are such characters in the midst. And here it says, those who stir and sow discord, or what we say, sow discord among brethren. How they destroy friendships. And here is speaking about gossiping and saying those things which are not good to hurt another person. Well, the Lord tells us that this must not be the character of God's people in his house. Let it be very far from his people. And it's very interesting that the prophet Isaiah, in Isaiah chapter 50, which we saw last week, how he mentioned these sins that were in the hearts or in the lives of God's people and how it had wreaked havoc. And the Lord tells us that these are things that He would hate. And the Lord tells us that we be very careful. And so amongst the people of God, how we would speak, the Lord wants us to have a measure of grace in our speech. A measure of grace is becoming of a child of God, so that there would be peace, there would be strength among the fellowship of God's people. You see, God is so good. He shows us what are those things that divides, what are those things that cause the people of God to fall, what are those things that threatens their prosperity. And God gives to us this seven sins, and He tells us that there is a way out. There is a way out. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, through His Word, when we spend time to hide God's Word in our heart, so much so that when we would be tempted to sin, the Spirit of God, the Word of God that is within us, would straight away prompt us to tell us, don't do that. When the voice of God speaks to you, don't dismiss it. Don't dismiss it. Because here is a warning. And if you've been spending time with the Lord, praying, in the study of God's Word, in your devotion, then there is that heightened sensitivity. The Lord will protect you. The Spirit of God will show you. And you would be sensitive enough to realize. And you say, ah. And we would take precaution. We would handle ourselves. That our eyes, our mouth, our hands, our feet would be measurably controlled so that we would be protected. May God help us. He has given us the power, the strength to overcome. And it's a choice that we have to make for good. May God gives us the strength to walk in the path of holiness, in the beauty of holiness, that it may be a life that is holiness unto the Lord. Let us pray. Father, we pray and ask that Thou be gracious to speak to our hearts, that You may search our hearts and help us to see those things that are not pleasing in our lives. Lord, may the searchlight of Your Word and Your Spirit show us where we have failed, where we have gone wrong. And may Thy Spirit also give to us the strength to repent, to be renewed. Lord, help us that we may find strength, that we may find a way out the danger, Lord, and show us after we have corrected ourselves the way of righteousness, that we may walk therein. how we may do that which is pleasing in thy sight, receiving thy blessings. This I pray with thanksgiving through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.